our informatics micro modules using dynamic programming to perform global alignment. In this module, we'll cover the basic algorithm. In dynamic programming, there are two basic concepts. The first concept is to decompose a complex problem into subproblems, each of which is easier to solve. The second concept is, whenever we solve a subproblem, we store its result, so that later, if we encounter the same problem again, we just take the result directly without solving it again. In the context of sequence alignment, suppose we want to align two sequences R and S of lengths M and N respectively. If M and N are large, this is a very difficult problem to solve. So we don't know what is the best alignment for these two sequences. Instead, we can first consider the first column of this alignment. Basically, we want to try all possibilities, and there are only three possibilities. The first one is, we put R1 and S1 into that column, and then we have a new subproblem, which is to align the remaining parts, R2 to M with N2 to N. The second possibility is, we put S1 into the first column of the alignment, and a gap from R. The third possibility is, we put R1 and a gap from S. So for each of these subproblems, if it is simple enough, then we solve it right away. But if it is still too difficult to solve, we can repeat the same process to decompose it into three subproblems and then see whether the subproblems are easy enough to solve. We can do that again and again until we reach a problem that is very easy to solve. So notice that each of these subproblems involves the alignment of a suffix of R and a suffix of S. Notice that the empty string, which is cutting out all characters from a string, is also considered a suffix. Now, one interesting thing about this process is that each subproblem actually appears multiple times in this so-called recursion tree. For example, for the subproblem of aligning R2 to M with S2 to N, it actually appears three times in this recursion tree, and they are marked with a red background. So if we have already solved the problem when we study the first branch of the tree, then when we encounter this problem again in second and third branches, we do not need to solve it again. Rather, we can take the result directly, and that is indicated by the blue arrows pointing to the red box. By doing that, we can actually save a lot of time. Now, how do we apply these ideas to solving the global alignment problem? First of all, let us recall the definition of the problem. The inputs again are two sequences, R of length M and S of length N. What we try to do is to find out the alignment or alignments of these two sequences with the highest alignment score among all possible alignments. Sometimes there's only one alignment achieving this score, and sometimes there are multiple of them. Since we are talking about global alignment, all characters in R and all characters in S must be involved in this alignment. In addition to the alignment or alignments themselves, of course, we also want to output the highest alignment score. So to illustrate the ideas, let us consider a very simple scoring scheme in this module, which is, whenever there's a match in the alignment, we give a score of +1. If it's a mismatch or invalid, we're going to give -1. There are a number of steps if we want to apply the dynamic programming ideas. The first one is, we define a table V, where the entry Vij, which is the entry at the ith row and jth column, is equal to the optimal alignment score of one of the subproblems, the one that is to align the suffix of R starting at I and the suffix of S starting at J. So that is essentially the score of one of the subproblems. By varying the values of I and J, the table V actually covers all possible subproblems to solve. Once the table is defined, we start to fill in some of the values. We start with those with very easy problems. For example, if you want to align the last character of R with an empty string, There is only one way, which is to align that character from R with a gap. According to our scoring scheme, that would be a mismatch with a score of minus 1, so we can easily put down a minus 1 there. And similarly, we can also put down the values of other EC cases. Then in the second step, we start to fill in other entries. Basically, if we want to fill in the value of an entry, there are three subproblems for that particular subproblem. So if all three subproblems have their values already computed, then we can just directly take their values and get the value for the current entry. We do this for every cell in the table until we have filled up all the entries. Then finally, we go to the upper left corner, which is V11. By definition, that corresponds to the alignment of R1 to M with S1 to N. That means our original problem of aligning the whole R with whole S. Now, to see how the ideas work in action, I'm showing you two different tables. The table on the right-hand side is the V table we just defined. They store the best alignment scores of the subproblems. On the left-hand side, there is another table that we're going to use to show the actual alignment. So notice that in reality, we do not need to store this table. It's very space-consuming to solve it. However, I'm putting it here just for illustration purpose. Later, we'll talk about the way that we can get back the best alignments even if we have only stored the best alignment scores. And for this example, we are considering to align two very short sequences. R is ACG and S is AGG. So in the first step, we put down the values of some entries that are very easy to put down. For example, now my mouse is pointing to the cell on the fourth row and the third column. That is corresponding to aligning an empty string with the G from S. As we know, there's only one way to align that. Correspondingly, if we look at the left-hand side, the way to align is put a gap to align with G, and the score is minus 1, so we can easily put down minus 1 here. Similarly, for the next one, we'll have minus 2 when we try to align GG with empty string, minus 3 when we try to align AGG with empty string, and so on. So similarly, we can do that for the last column. Here, we also see some red arrows. The meaning of the red arrows is like this. If the value of a subproblem is due to the value of another subproblem, then we put down an arrow from the second problem to the first problem. For example, here there's a minus 2. The reason that we have minus 2 is because we are aligning the empty string from R with GG from S. We can think in this way. The reason that we get minus 2 is because, first of all, we align the first G with a gap. And then we have a new subproblem. And the result of the subproblem is indicated by the next cell, which is minus 1. This is an important way of thinking, because every time we just solve the very first part, we do not solve the whole subproblem. Otherwise, we'll repeat and repeat the same problem solving again. Here, rather, we just take the result directly from the next subproblem and then add one extra indel to that. So that's why we have a red arrow. Now, we try to fill in some other entries. For example, for the entry on the third row and third column, we want to know what would be the best alignment score when we align a G from R and a G from S. That is, of course, obvious from a human perspective, but systematically, there are three possibilities. The first possibility is we align this R3 with S3, which is to put the two Gs together in the same column. So if we do that, then we have consumed all the characters in the two sequences. So we have no more subproblem, so for the new subproblem, the value is 0. And now, because we are putting the two Gs in the same column, we're introducing a match, so we're going to have a plus 1 score to the final score. So if we take this diagonal path, the final score for this subproblem will be 0 plus 1, that is 1. Another possibility is, we align a gap with S3, if we do that, that would be a new subproblem because R3 is still unaligned. So we'll go to that subproblem and ask what would be the optimal score for that subproblem, and we know that that is minus 1. And for this step, because we are introducing an indel, aligning a gap with G, so we are going to have a minus 1 score. That is the horizontal path. Finally, we can also take the reverse way. We can say we align R3 with a gap, and then we have a new subproblem. The new subproblem has a score of minus 1, and we're introducing an additional minus 1 in this step. So if we take this step, the final score will be minus 2. Comparing the three possibilities, the first one will give us a score of 1, the second one minus 2, the third one minus 2. So the best case is actually the diagonal one. And that's why we put down the value of that path, which is 1, into this cell, and we mark that corresponding arrow red. Now we move on to the next entry, which is the one on the third column and second row. Again, there are three possibilities. The first one is, here, if we put the two corresponding characters in the same column, which is to align the C and G, then we're going to introduce a mismatch. And for the new subproblem, to align G with empty string, we already know from the table the optimal alignment score for that is minus 1. So if we take this diagonal path, the final score for this cell is minus 1, minus 1, that is minus 2. The second case is, we align gap with S3. So the new subproblem we already know has a score of minus 2, and we're introducing an indel. So total score for this path will be minus 3. Finally, if we align R2 with the gap, then we have a new subproblem of aligning the G with the G. We just solved that, and we know the optimal score for that problem is 1. Here, we're introducing an indel. So if we take this path, the final score will be 0. Again, if we compare the three possibilities, the first one is minus 2, second one is minus 3, third one is 0. So the third one is the best. So we'll put down this value. And then we also mark the corresponding arrow red. We can repeat this process for every cell in this table. Finally, we'll have a table like this. We fill in all the entries and we mark all the red arrows. For each entry, there will be at least one and sometimes more than one red arrow pointing in. So the last step is we go to the upper left corner. As seen from the table on the right-hand side, the final score is 1. That means aligning ACG and AGG, the optimal way, will give a value of 1. And that is actually quite obvious, because the best way to align these two sequences is not to introduce any gaps. Then we're going to have two matches and one mismatch, leading to a score of 1. And we also see the corresponding alignment on the left-hand side. So as I said, we do not need to store the left table. In reality, we only need the right table. Later, we'll see how we can get back this best alignment based on the right table alone. Now, let us summarize what we have learned in this module. After defining the V table, in the initialization step, based on our simple scoring scheme, we first fill in the lower right corner with a 0, and then for the last row and last column, we just fill in the corresponding negative numbers. Then we have a recursive formula for every cell Vij, which is the optimal alignment score between aligning Ri to M and Sj to N. There are three cases. Either we put the first characters of these two suffixes, that means Ri and Sj, in the same column. Depending on whether they are the same or not, we're going to have a plus 1 score or minus 1 score. And then we are going to have a new subproblem to align the remaining part, Ri plus 1 to M and Sj plus 1 to N. Second possibility is we're going to align a gap with Sj. Since this is introducing an indel, we have a minus 1. And then we have a new subproblem. Third possibility is we align Ri with a gap. We're introducing an indel again, and we're going to have a new subproblem. That is the basic idea of using dynamic programming to solve the global alignment problem. In the next module, we're going to see how we can trace back to get the optimal alignment from the V table alone. And also, what if we have other scoring schemes?